you are going to study the piano and there's nothing you could do about it. And, you know, I was 7 years old, so I couldn't really leave the house or, you know, do anything. So I'm very thankful for them buying the piano against without asking me. And here I am now. So the first time I heard a song that I produced on the radio was Broccoli with D.R.A.M featuring Lil Yachty in 2016. And I remember being in disbelief and instantly calling my parents. And I remember I called my dad and told him that the song was on the radio, and he actually hadn't heard the song yet. And the first thing he told me was that he didn't like the bad words in the lyrics, but he was really proud of me. I was driving in the car. I was flipping between Power 106 and Kiss FM, and was hoping, because everyone was saying, oh, I heard it on the radio. So when one day I was driving and it caught me off guard, it just started playing right away, and I heard the piano keys, and I just kind of freaked out and stopped the car and just was trying to soak it all in. And then after that, I kept hearing it more and more, and it still feels crazy when I hear it today, when I hear anything I've done on the radio today. The first time being Grammy nominated was an incredible feeling. It was like I had to refresh the page and make sure that that was really what I was seeing. It was like to see the feeling of all the hard work that I'd done paying off and finally being honored to the highest degree was like unbelievable. And just getting all the support texts from friends and family and colleagues and everybody, it was like, I could get used to this. Like, I gotta keep working hard. So, yeah. I first met Doja in 2016, and I was working at the studio where D.R.A.M was at a lot, and my good friend Yeti, he owned the studio and was always hanging around and kind of just one day asked me, hey, do you want to come work with me and this artist that I'm working with, Doja Cat? And I was like, absolutely. So I remember our first session, we were working on her first record, and it was such a fun day. We were there all day, all night, just making songs, having fun, talking, laughing, getting to know each other. And I knew from the beginning, when I met her, Doja was a really special person and an incredible artist. And I knew from the beginning that she was going to be a big star, and she definitely is now and has lived up to it. So that was a really special day that I'll never forget. And we, I think, worked on two or three songs that ended up on her first album and sort of established the musical chemistry and connection, and have been working together with Yeti and Doja ever since. The first time I saw a Marvel movie, I believe that I can remember, was Spider-Man, one of the earliest one with Tobey Maguire. And I remember always being fascinated by all the music, the soundtrack, like all the elements of the movie. And, you know, fast forward to now, like having a song that I produced and wrote with my really close friends in an amazing Marvel film is like still unbelievable to me. So that's something I've always wanted to, you know, check off my list, and it feels pretty cool that it happened. The first time that I worked with D.R.A.M was really memorable and special because we were at Rick Rubin's studio, Shangri-La in Malibu, and we basically just had like a 3-hour jam session with a bunch of musicians, and we really just clicked together. A lot of the stuff that I was doing, he would kind of just look at me and give me like the nod of approval. And we definitely formed this really special musical bond because he was somebody that thought outside the box and did his own thing. And, you know, we both come from different backgrounds musically, but it meshed together so well because he was so appreciative and respectful of my classical background. So after that jam session, he called me back to come into the studio and make some stuff like from scratch, and that's when we started working on the album, and also when we ended up making Broccoli and a bunch of other great songs. I think the first time I really felt that feeling was 2017 when a song I co-produced called Bad at Love by Halsey came out. I remember getting brought into the studio because I hadn't heard it in a while, and I had made the track like a year before, and they were like, "Hey, we want to bring you into the studio so you can just hear the song and, you know, make sure everything's cool." And I heard it and thought to myself, "This sounds like this is going to be huge." I don't know what it is, it just feels like that. And sure enough, it became one of the favorites from the album, and you know, a few months go by and I was hearing it on the radio all the time. So that feeling came back again. I was like, oh, this is really happening. My first time performing, I was, I believe, around 7 or 8 years old, and my first piano teacher used to hold these, you know, these recitals, these piano recitals in her home. She had this big living room, and it was basically like a little concert hall. So they'd have like refreshments on the side, and all the parents and family would be watching. And I think when I was younger, I really wasn't fazed by audiences or nerves or anything like that. And I just remember going up there, playing the piece, and then, you know, everyone clapping. I go sit down. I'm like, oh, you just go up there for a minute or two and play. But then I remember I'd start seeing the other kids, the other students that my teacher had, and they were all playing way more advanced pieces than I was. And every time I would hear them play, I'd be sitting next to my dad, and he'd look at me and be like, you can play that piece, right? You're able to learn that, right?" And he was always kind of pushing me to get better and advance myself. So I think performing sort of came natural to me, and I just, you know, I love showing people what I can do. So it's still with me today. Working with Dre was one of the most incredible experiences in my life and in my career. It was, I remember the first time meeting him. I actually didn't know I was being brought to his studio. I was working with one of my mentors, who goes by the name Mailman, and he basically was like my number one teacher and supporter when it came to making beats and learning about hip hop. And he had surprised me one day and brought me to Dre's studio. So I walked inside and remember seeing Dre mixing on an SSL board, like, and he turned around and looked at me and pointed at me and was like, "I heard you're nice on the keys, and we're gonna put you to the test." So we ended up working that night on a track and working till like 3 or 4 in the morning and just bouncing ideas off of each other. Like, he was having me try all sorts of different things with sounds, with the way I was playing chords, with the way I was doing stuff, and it was really like nothing I'd ever experienced at that time. So he had told me to come work with him, and I was starting to show up to his studio, and basically whenever he was inspired to work or when there was stuff to do, I would always be there, working with the other producers, working with the whole Aftermath team. And that was definitely one of the most important times in my life and career, because Dre really showed me and everybody in there, like, this is how you produce. It's not just playing an instrument, it's not just making the beat and programming drums and sending beats out. It's like talking to people, it's digging into their full potential. Whether you were a guitarist or a keys player or a songwriter or a programmer, like, he knows what sound will make the song special, and he would always dig for that out of everybody. So we made some incredible stuff together, and I'll never forget the things that he taught me and the way he inspired me. So I'm really, really grateful for that whole opportunity. The moment I knew I wanted to become a musician, I remember I was a young kid watching. I was watching that movie, The Pianist, and there's a moment in the film at the end of the movie where he plays this piece by Chopin, and it's it that performance ended up saving his life because, you know, he was I don't know if everyone knows the movie, but he was like hiding from, you know, Nazis and stuff like that. And one of the officers discovered him, and he played this piece by Chopin called the Ballade Number 1 in G minor. And I remember when I heard that piece, which is the piece that I was telling you about, I wanted to learn on my own. That was the piece that changed my life. That was the piece that opened up all the possibilities for me harmonically and like melody wise and like just it I'm like, if somebody can write a piece this incredible and perform it, I want to be able to carry that tradition on and bring that life to wherever I go in music. So hearing that piece definitely changed my whole perspective, definitely gave me the confidence that I needed to move in whatever direction I was heading towards, which at the time I still didn't know. I wanted to be a concert pianist, and now I'm producing records for people. But it all goes hand in hand and comes full circle, and I'll never forget how special that was to me. So I'm always gonna, you know, have that with me, have that passion with me.